know anything about that?
Yeah, I do. Problem solved.
All right. How's this work?
I think it's on right now.
Yeah, okay.
But you can also use this if you want.
Okay, I'm not going to touch that. All right, we have less than 1 minute to go. It is Steve Clark, right? Good afternoon. My name is Dale McKeel. I'm the bicycle and pedestrian coordinator for the City of Durham. Welcome to the city. This afternoon, we have a presentation from Steve Clark. He is with the League of American Bicyclists, and his title is the Bicycle Friendly Community Specialist. And he told me he is probably the only person in the world with that title. So Steve has a very interesting job this year. He's traveled to 70 cities across the country, working with them to become more bicycle friendly. And the League of American Bicyclists is a great organization. If you're not familiar with them, if you're a bicyclist, I would encourage you to become a member, because they promote bicycling in so many different ways. One of their programs is the Bicycle Friendly Community Program. And for someone like myself, who is in a position of trying to improve conditions for bicycling, it's a great program, because they have a very specific application process. They ask a lot of questions about what you're doing in your community, and it really gives you a checklist of things that you can do to improve conditions in your community. Durham was first designated a bicycle-friendly community at the bronze level back in 2010, and we just completed an application a couple months ago to be reconsidered. We have some materials in the back of the room. The Durham Bike and Hike Map is one of those materials. These are also available at local bike shops. So without further ado, I'll introduce Steve and welcome him to Durham.
Thank you. Well, being a bicyclist, I just have to move, right? So I'm gonna hold the mic and move around. Hopefully the camera can keep track of me. So I've had the great fortune of being able to be employed in this work pretty much my entire adult life. I started out in Boulder, Colorado as their first bicycle program manager back in the early 80s. And then I worked for the Minnesota Department of Public Safety as a community bike safety program specialist, and then I worked as a consultant. My most recent job was as the non-motorized transportation pilot program manager with the city of Minneapolis. The focus was Minneapolis, but I worked for a nonprofit organization, and we had the fun job of deciding how to spend $25 million to improve conditions for bicyclists and pedestrians. And when we pretty much had spent all the money, I saw that this job with the league had opened up, and I went for it, and here I am today. But now I have indisputable proof that the world has really changed. So it changed about three years ago, and here's why. I'm talking to my dad, and he says to me, "You know, Steve, this bicycling thing, it's not just a toy anymore." people are starting to take this seriously. You might have a future in this. Thanks, Dad. So I don't know what he thought, you know, what I was doing before 3 years ago, but now I have a future. All right. So the world has changed. But I mean, I think my dad does reflect kind of, you know, mainstream America, in that all of a sudden there's this huge interest in bicycling, and people are starting to embrace it as something that truly is, if it's not a societal solution, it certainly is being embraced as an individual solution to health issues. And I mean, you know, you can't open the newspaper out without seeing something about, you know, crazy weather patterns or energy vulnerability, congestion. I mean, there's all these complex problems that we face, and here's this little thing that was invented back in the 1880s or before that, where the organization that I belong to and work for, the League of American Bicyclists, we were the League of American Wheelmen. There was a bicycle boom back in the 1880s. We were actually, you can blame us for all the paved roads, because we were the people that we, as if I was there then. No, but they pushed, lobbied for the good roads movement, which allowed for the emergence of the automobile, you could say, because now we have good pavement. But anyway, I digress. But so this thing that was a pretty simple invention, it's got the amazing potential to transform communities, and we're seeing that everywhere now, where it's being embraced because it really does make sense. It's the most efficient way to move a human being. Actually, it's the most efficient form of locomotion ever created by evolution or man's invention or by God's creation, whatever you want to, however you want to spin it. Nothing matches the bicycle, a human being on a bicycle, for efficiency. Of course, you have to have maybe some smooth roads too to make that efficient. So, and it doesn't take up much space. So anyway, I'm really happy to be here in Durham. This is, like Dale said, my number 70th city that I'm visiting. So that's kind of cool. And by the time I'm done with this trip, I'll be done with my commitment for 2014, which is to have visited 75 cities. I'll be one above that, so nobody can say I didn't do my job. And then we'll be doing another 100 cities next year and another 100 cities in 2016. So this is made possible by the support of Trek. And normally I would be riding. Who rode on the ride today? Great. It was a good ride, right? In fact, you recognize this is who rode on the ride today, right there. Trek is allowing for these travels to take place, and normally I would be riding a Trek, but I couldn't bring my bike on the Amtrak from, I started in New York City on this trip, and because of all the, you know, they just have too many people, passengers, so I've been borrowing and begging for bikes and using bike share where it's available. I finally got tired of all that, and I bought a $100 bike on Craigslist when I was in Raleigh on Saturday. So, and I was able to ride my $100 bicycle from Raleigh to Durham. So it was a lot of fun. And, you know, I try to, for my travels, I really try to incorporate as much bicycling as possible. So I'll take my bike out of the box at the airport, put it together, and then ride to wherever my hotel is. And that way I really can see, you know, what's happening, and is bicycling a viable, safe means of transportation? In some cities, of airports are very bicycle friendly, and all the way into downtown, it's wonderful. In other cities, it's almost a nightmare experience. But I'm a pretty assertive rider, and so far, I've survived. So it must be okay, right? we should go back to this, because is not the greatest photo, sorry about that, but this really, when we're talking about what makes a bicycle-friendly community, ultimately, it's people, the people who are here, the people who are on this ride, And one thing that I've learned from these travels, the communities where that are truly on a momentum, that are doing things that, you know, 10 years ago people would have said, oh, there's no way this will happen here, it can't be done. The reason why those things are happening is because of the right people coming together and making a difference in their community. And I call it the three-legged stool, where you have your first of all, citizen advocates or proponents, right, that say, this is important. This is the kind of community that we want to live in. We want a high quality of life here. This is important. So you have that, and normally there's some kind of advocacy group. So there's Bike Durham now, which is doing some great things. There's a bike co-op here. People, the bike shops are kind of on the front lines of this movement, seeing customers, new people who want to get into bicycling. So there's that component, that leg of the stool. And then you've got your dedicated staff like Dale and Phil, the traffic engineer, that just, you know, they work at this. They study what makes good design, the best education programs, et cetera, and they're willing to implement those things. But they need elected official support. So there's the staff, the dedicated staff, the citizens, and then people like we met Steve, what's his last name? Shul. Great guy. Is he here? No, he couldn't. Okay, there he is. Yeah. All right. So TV can aim right at that. Council member Shul. But truly, people who understand that these, when we're talking about this public space that sometimes we call roads, it's about political decisions. It's not about, oh, we can't do this because capacity won't allow us, right? These are political issues. It's who are we prioritizing on these streets and why? Does this reflect our community values? So again, that's a three-legged stool. That's reflected in the people who came on the ride today. It's reflected in this room right here. And when you have all those three things to combine, the advocates that will make Dale look moderate, you need that, so he can do his job more effectively. The elected official who's willing to use their political capital, some political will to get the job done, and understand that these are policy issues and not just something to be left up to the conventional traffic engineers who were trained just for sort of really one mode, but that's changing now. And you've got a great traffic engineer here. Phil, are you here? He doesn't want, where are you? All right, never mind. And so that's the difference, why some cities are moving forward and some aren't. So the Bicycle Friendly Community Program, which I'm part of, really started in like 2000. It didn't get off the ground in a major way until 2003. And by 2007, there were a handful of communities, really a good representation from around the country, that had become bicycle-friendly communities through our designation, our recognition process. But by 2013, it really has taken off. But as of last year, 2014, as of spring of 2014, we had received over 700 applications. 304 communities are now recognized as bicycle friendly. So it's not like, oh, you send in an application, you become bicycle friendly, even though it takes a long time to fill out those applications. There are over 100 questions, some of them are pretty involved. And so a lot of communities, I mean, more than half, do not get the designation, and they're a little bit upset with us because it's like, hey, we did all this work, come on. Well, it's not so easy. But we do give them lots of feedback, so the next time they'll be more successful. We have, right now, four categories that cities can be in one of those four categories of bicycle friendliness. Bronze is the beginning level, which is where Durham is at. Then it's silver, gold, and four communities in this country are at platinum. Anybody want to guess what four those might B? Minneapolis, yes? No, actually, I'm from Minneapolis, but unfortunately, no. Gold is Minneapolis. Portland is one. Boulder is two. Yay, Boulder. Davis, California. Wow, you guys are good. Davis, California. And there's one more that people, it's the newest one. And mostly it has to do with the new Belgian brewery that moved into town in Fort Collins. Yeah, they've done so much in terms of bike culture there and events. And now infrastructure is quite good, too. So those are the four platinum, but they're all aspiring to be the first community in this country to get diamond. And that hasn't happened yet. This is not something you want to study. Wait. Okay, yeah. So the program, yes, you do want to study this, the five E's. The program is based on a comprehensive approach. And not just what's on the ground, but your education, that's one of the E's, your evaluation. So how many are these treatments working? That requires evaluation. Where are the crashes happening? That requires evaluation. Another E, encouragement. So what kinds of events are happening? Why are you doing bike to work days? Are you giving incentives when people bike to work? The last place I worked at, I received $3 every time I rode my bicycle or walked to work. And that wasn't why I did it, but it was kind of nice that, you know, when I wanted to buy a new bike and my spouse was like, hey, you have already got like how many bikes? I can say, hey, this doesn't really cost us anything because, you know, this is like I get $3 every time I bike and, you know, that added up to like over $200 or more. No, yeah. Anyway, I don't remember. But anyway, it was a good way to, you know, justify spending more money on my bicycle habit. So encouragement efforts, evaluation, education, engineering. That's what we looked at today when we were out on our bike ride. What's another E? Enforcement. So we had an officer at the pre-ride meeting, and it's great to see you've got officers on bikes, but we're also looking at, you know, what the whole the justice system is like, and, you know, when a cyclist gets a ticket, which we encourage, is there a way to, you know, have a diversion program where they can go to a safety class and maybe have that fine reduced, those kinds of things. In some cities, the police officers give out free lights, and other places they do a positive reinforcement campaign where they give kids that are doing the right thing tickets to the movie theater or something. So there's all kinds of things that we promote in our bicycle friendly community program. But those are the five E's. Now we're actually talking about a six E. Anybody want to guess what that might be? Equity, very good. So we're trying to incorporate equity into all the other E's so that we're making sure that the investments made are really being equitably distributed into the neighborhoods that sometimes get ignored. So on my way from Raleigh, I was on Angier Street and Pettigrew, and I thought, you know, these would be some great corridors to really make bike friendly. And I have some ideas that I'm going to share with you today, how to turn those narrow roads, high speed roads, into something that would be more bicycle friendly. Not so hard. So again, quality bike products. You know, I talked about the $3 a day that I got when I was employed with the Transit for Livable Communities folks. This manufacturer of bike parts, and just mostly a distributor, paid their employees also $3 a day to walk or bike. And it was such a success that they actually found out they saved money in healthcare costs. So this is another reason why people are paying attention to bicycling as a solution. People become healthier, they become more productive workers. It really works. And we know also that cities that start investing in infrastructure and programs, they do see a dramatic increase in bicycling. So let's talk about and this is the one that you can ignore because it's too hard to read. It's just to prove to you that we have a set of metrics that we're using when we decide if a city is bronze, silver, gold, or platinum. And basically, you know, it's looking at all those five E's and then looking at the outcomes. And when you have all, we really like to think of our program as being this blueprint for how to get the kinds of positive outcomes that a community might be looking for in terms of increased ridership, decreased crash rates, and decreased fatality rates. And as you look at those platinum communities, their crash rate is very low, and their fatality rate is very low, and their ridership is very high. So we know it works. So here's what, in terms of the top, these are the largest cities in the country, top 70 largest cities. And, you know, so Portland's leading the pack of the largest cities with 6.1% ridership. D.C. just replaced Minneapolis as number two. Of course, you know, there's a little bit of margin of error in the ACS. This is just the trip to work, right? So, and it's the longest part of that trip to work. So if, in fact, you are, you know, commuting by bus for 4 miles and then and riding a bike 3 miles, you have to count that as a bus trip. But this is the only metric that we have that's consistent across all communities. Therefore, we use it. What do you suppose Durham is at? Any ideas? Probably Dale knows. Well, here's another. You're not in the top 20 yet. Chicago's got you beat a little bit. You're at 1%, all right? But look at this, 144% increase since 2000. So you are on a roll. The average community, I mean, nationwide, we're seeing increases like about 60%. So you're more than double the national average. And even among the bike-friendly communities, that average increase is about 85%, so you're above that as well. So congratulations. So this just shows you that what you're doing is working, and it's going to continue. You're going to continue to see more people using bicycles to get to work. How many people actually right now commute to work with a bike? Wow. So you guys are the anomaly in this city. Congratulations. Yeah, well, there should be a separate category. I mean, so you bike to shop, you bike to go to the restaurants, you bike to meet people, socialize, and for fun. Yeah, and unfortunately, ACS doesn't include any of that good stuff. So I'm going to show you a pyramid that kind of represents how we look at a community and what the priorities are. And normally I have you guess what the different, like, what's the most important thing when you come into a community to work on, and for the longest time, the most important thing would be to get rid of the legal impediments to bicycling. Because in a lot of places, when I started doing this work, a lot of places, the main street in town was banned to bicycling. And so the whole emphasis was to say, let's make bicyclists have the same rights as, or the same privileges, I guess you could say, as motorists, to be able to use this public space. And that was a big battle, but now in all 50 states, the operator of a bicycle has the same rights as the operator of a motor vehicle, and responsibilities for the most part. Once you get that legal access, then you start making it as safe as possible, right? So that's, you know, safety is really huge. And making it as pleasant, that becomes the next phase. So anyway, if all you did was make it legal to ride a bike everywhere, you'd have a very small, what this pyramid represents, or triangle, the very top thing, even though that might be the most important thing to work on at first, if that's all you do, it's going to be a very small percentage of your population actually using bikes. You make it legal and safe, a lot more people will start riding bikes. You make it legal, safe, and pleasant, like your trail system, the American Tobacco Trail,
a lot more people start using bikes. But the key, and this is what the Europeans have discovered long ago, is that if you really want to get people bicycling from point A to point B, especially, you know, for transportation, you make it easier, more convenient, advantageous to bike than to drive a car. And we're not quite there yet. We do a lot of things, and I'll show you some examples. But, what Copenhagen has done to create incentives for bicycling and what you could call disincentives for driving are things that most people in our United States cities would never go for, like 180% sales tax on buying a car. $20,000 car costs, what, $58,000 in Copenhagen. That's a disincentive. But here's an example of the, of a trail, a corridor, a facility that actually does provide safety, legal access, very pleasant, and in some places it actually makes a shortcut too, right? So, good example, and to make it additional, to enhance the safety, there's a wonderful bike watch, but what do you call it? Yes, the trail watch, folks, and it was great. I'm sorry, your Mike was there explaining just how that operates and all the volunteer hours that goes into that to make it the best experience for people possible. So we like to see those kinds of things. So here's the other thing that I'm finding out when I travel is that some of the cities that you least suspect to be really into bicycling are just, they've embraced this incredibly, and they have these wonderful signature projects like the bike bridge at Overland Park. This is in Memphis. You can't see this very well, but maybe on the TV screen, if you watch this again, you'll see just how incredible this bridge is. Or it's not really a bridge, but it you go on the arch. It's really cool. Who's been to Memphis and has seen? Yeah, it's pretty cool, isn't it? And this is actually, Overland Park has an interesting history. It's the first place in this country where citizens were able to stop the construction of a freeway, the part of the interstate system. And now it's a park instead of a freeway. And with bike access through the park. So I'm going to show you some other examples of just neat things that are going on around the country. Here's in Lexington, Kentucky, another place that you wouldn't really think of as bike friendly necessarily. This is a bridge that connects two off-street facilities together. This was kind of a gap in the system. But rather than having people cross over on a kind of a busy area, now basically you access both parts of the trail on what's just been divided from the roadway space. So it's a seamless connection using green paint, bollards, very inexpensive, but it worked. It works. Oakland, California, they were one of the first cities to really embrace road diets. So in this case, this had been a four-lane configuration, like your club road. Like you've done some road diets here. Y'all are aware of the Main Street and Chapel Hill. Wonderful example here, because this is an area where people said, no way, you can't do a road diet here. It's 26,000 cars a day. You're out of your mind. They did it. It transformed this street, Lakeshore Drive. And now what used to be a very hostile place for walkers, joggers, bicyclists has been transformed. The neat thing about these road diets where you do a 4-to-3 conversion is when you don't need that center lane for a shared left turning lane, you can put in the pedestrian refuge islands. So that's what you have here, a place now people can cross the street and wait until it's safe to cross again. So there's so many good things about road diets that the FHWA, the Federal Highway Safety Administration, they're now encouraging, promoting, I said safety, it's not, there's no safety in there. But in there, they have a website called the 9 Proven Safety Countermeasures. Road diets are one of the things that they feature very prominently because 29% crash reduction, all types of crashes. So you don't even have to sell them as a way to provide bike lanes, but they do that too. But you can sell them just because four-lane configurations are inherently dangerous. And you know why. I mean, you've all driven on a four-lane configuration. You're constantly jockeying for position. Go from left lane to right lane, especially if you're late for a meeting. And there's lots of side swipes, rear end collisions. There's no place for, you know, to actually make those left turns from, separate from the through lanes. So people just do crazy things, and speeds tend to be kind of erratic. You do a 4-3, typically you can still accommodate the same number of vehicles. Sometimes you have to tweak the signals and look at what's going on at the side streets. But now you make it safer for pedestrians, safer for bicyclists, you have your own dedicated space. You could actually argue that because now bicyclists don't have to take the full lane and they have their own space. That space in Copenhagen, a single cycle track is supporting 22,000 bicyclists a day. Just the narrowness of a bike lane on both sides of a street. 22,000. So you could argue that actually by doing the 4-3, you're increasing capacity because now bicycles can be in that mix. And that has happened. Chicago has shown, in fact, some of their road diets, the capacity has increased when they start counting the increased use by bicyclists. Pretty cool. Speaking of Chicago, they're also doing some things that are pretty innovative with what's called these protected bike lanes. And this happens to be a two-way protected bike lane on a one-way street. Remember that one thing about advantageous? When you do two-way facility on a one-way street, that gives bicyclists advantages that people driving a car don't have. And you know, let's face it, bicyclists really don't want to go an extra block out of the way. You have still quite a few one-way streets here in Durham, and those one-way streets work well for motorists, but they are a barrier to bicyclists and people on foot. And this, if you can get some of those converted to two ways, that would make a big difference. I would also suggest Watts has at Trinity, it's a lovely street as a bike boulevard kind of a street, very, very comfortable for bicycling, but then suddenly it becomes a one-way at Trinity. And that would be a good place just to allow bicycles. And this could just be done by signs. Bikes exempt or bikes accepted from the one way, but then at crossings you have to make sure that people realize that bikes might, there's this contra flow going on. In Copenhagen, every one-way street for cars is automatically two-way for bikes. It's just part of their ordinance. Now again, safety is more important than advantageous, so you have to make sure doing something like that was actually safe, right? Okay. St. Louis doing some great things. These are buffered bike lanes now. So the buffer in this case is, and this is just paint, but kind of painting a no man's land next to the door zone so that people are safer, they're more visible being out in the traffic. Not in the traffic, but just further from the door zone. In some cities, the buffer zone is on the traffic side of things. And in some places where they have a sufficient room, they'll do it on both. Seattle, another example of a two-way cycle track. So Dale, I didn't ask you this earlier, but are you looking at any protected bike lanes in Durham as a possibility? So it may be happening. Dale says yes. And again, this is another, both Seattle, where this is typically done, the two-way configuration is going to be where you have a one-way street and you're doing it so that the contra flow bicycle lane really is on the right side So these are always typically on the left side of a one-way. I don't know if you can understand what I'm saying. But basically, so the contra flow movement makes sense that you're on the right side of the road using your bike in the contra flow movement. And then you have to treat the protected bike lanes really as a separate roadway to do it right. You can't have motorists thinking they have the right to turn at the same time bicyclists think they have a green to go through, because that can add problems. Market Street in San Francisco, one of the most famous streets in the country, now you have, this is a great shot because it shows the bike sharing going on, green bike lane that's buffered, and then further down it becomes protected with physical vertical elements. And just ahead of the person in this photo is this, but this is actually from Portland, which is a counter that every bicyclist that passes and motorist to see this counts what number you are that day. And this was at about 8 o'clock at night in Portland. It was already at 3,660. And I mean, that is like, wow, and this is just one of their bridges in Portland. So when you cross that as a bicyclist, it's like this immediate sort of feedback that you count and that there's lots of biking going on in your city. So we like to see that. They tell me that by the end of the evening or nighttime, it's going to hit 5,000 every day. That's a lot of bicyclists. And that, you know, when that happens, motorists can't say, why are you doing all this stuff for bicyclists? You know, there's not, nobody bikes in this town. Well, obviously they can't say that. So Minneapolis, I got to work in Minneapolis quite a bit, and we were able to bring in some neat things from Europe to try in Minneapolis. And one of the things we kept hearing on some of the key corridors is, sorry, Steve, there's just not enough space for bike lanes, and we can't possibly get rid of on-street parking. So and some places you don't even have on-street parking, like your Angier and Pettigrew. It's a narrow roadway, right? So what do you do when you don't have space for actual solid lines to demarcate a bike lane? But you want to suggest that, hey, this is a place where bicycles are welcomed. You do advisory bike lanes. So what about campus drive? So the way this works, first of all, the Manual for Uniform Traffic Control Devices, MUTCD, says you don't need the center stripe if you have fewer than 6,000 cars a day. So you get rid of the center stripe. That's number one. And they're actually doing this in England now in places up to 10,000. Actually, I've read 15,000 cars a day, because they're finding safety benefits of getting rid of the center stripe. This is what it looks like in Europe. All right, this is a two-way roadway. Bikes, but it feels so different than what Angier felt to me yesterday, or even Campus Drive. Now, Campus Drive is like a two-foot shoulder, and then it's gone completely. But imagine if there wasn't that yellow center line at all, and instead you had a five or six foot dash bike lane. The way advisory bike lanes work, the dashes allow motorists to use that space when there's not a bicyclist in that space. All it really does is reinforce traffic law, traffic principles. You can't run over a bicyclist when they're in front of you, right? And if they're not in front of you, you can be in that space. What we have found is that it changes driving behavior dramatically. So, in the case of Minneapolis, we had to study this because this is an experimental treatment. FHWA said, yeah, no, we've never done this in this country. You have to study it. So we had video cameras. First of all, the bicycle numbers doubled. This is in just on the edge of downtown Minneapolis. Secondly, bikes got off the sidewalk. We had like a 30% sidewalk riding rate before this was tried. It went down to 2% on the sidewalk, which is good because sidewalk riding, we know that leads to increased bike crashes. Three, motorists gave more room when passing bicyclists, which was, we didn't know that that would happen at all. That was an unexpected victory. Four, bicyclists stayed further out of the door zone, which is huge because that's what we're teaching all the time, stay out of that door zone. But the thing that was most surprising of all is that we had, on average, 8 to 10 crashes per year along the 7-block stretch on East 14th Street in Minneapolis. Mostly car crashes. A few were bike car crashes and a few car ped crashes. But on average, just around 10 a year. This went in, and of course we thought, oh, this could really kind of like be crazy because motorists might start running into each other with being confused. Zero crashes since this was put in. And nobody can explain really why, except that people are driving differently. They're more careful. And then, yeah, they're probably confused. Maybe that's a good thing. And there was a lot of flack. Okay, because between those dashes, there's only 14 feet remaining. Not everywhere, but in some of the areas, it's between 14 and 17 feet that remains. And so you can't have the center line and you know, you can't have 7-foot travel lanes. But this isn't taking away the travel lanes. That space is still available to the motorists. So it really is like this incredible. And, you know, again, the Europeans discovered this long ago. And now more and more cities are doing this. But I think it'd be a great thing for streets like Anger, Pettigrew, where you just can't have the money or the right-of-way to widen the roadway. You don't need more pavement. You just need to have the visual cues that tell people this is where we welcome bicyclists. They're more effective than Cheryl's, is what we found. So, and you know, so the question was, what about slowing down traffic? Most studies have shown that yes, you do slow down traffic. In Minneapolis, that wasn't the case. I mean, it got rid of some of the outliers, but the average speed still remained around 29 miles per hour, which seems strange to me because it just seemed, I don't know. That's what the study showed, that the speeds didn't really decrease at all. But then there wasn't really a speeding problem because this is a fairly, I don't know, it's short blocks and people weren't going terribly fast. But I would think that, yes, and probably were in here in Durham, you'd see some slower speeds, especially when you have bicyclists. I mean, and sometimes it's confusing, right? Because people think they shouldn't be in that space ever. So you just have to have this education that, no, a dash line means you can move into that space when there's not a bicyclist there. So there's a good video. You could Google Minneapolis Bike Advisory Lanes and see a nice video that they produced to educate people about it. So Madison is a... You know, we talked about giving advantages to bicyclists. Madison is a place where they just recently started doing bicycle boulevards, or neighborhood greenways is what Portland calls them. And what to make them work, the goal is to optimize these streets for bicycle and pedestrian movement. And one way you optimize it for being on a bicycle is to get rid of as many stop signs as possible. Because, hey, let's face it, bicyclists really don't like to stop at stop signs. Every time you stop at a stop sign and actually come to a complete stop and start out again, for the average bicyclist, you use the same amount of energy as going across the entire length of a football field. So, you know, there's this thing called inertia. You just want to keep going. So, yes, the best bicycle boulevards have very few stop signs. So, like, Watts is a great candidate for a bike boulevard because instead of some stop signs, you've got traffic circles. And you know, they work great for bikes because you can just keep your same speed. And they work good for traffic calming because motorists have to kind of slow down if they're designed right to move around them. But oftentimes we reverse the easy thing to do when you don't have a ton of money to build traffic circles is just to reverse as many stop signs as possible, get rid of them. And when you do that, you run into the situation where now all of a sudden more people want to drive on those streets because, hey, not too many stop signs, I'll go fast on this nice little residential street and avoid the busier street that's congested next to it. So to prevent that, you do what like Madison has done and what Portland has done and Minneapolis and other places, which is to divert traffic. And this is a very simple diversion. It's just simply a sign that says, do not enter, which is actually what you have on Watts, right, where it becomes a one-way. But this isn't actually a one-way here on this bicycle boulevard. It's just you cannot enter that particular spot, but then it's two-way again. So I don't know what the people who live right next to that, where they're parked, if they do sort of a U-turn when they get to the end or if they just sneak through and hope that there's nobody, no officer to give them a ticket. Because certainly, I mean, emergency vehicles and people can still get through there. They did put a big, elaborate curb extension. But anyway, that's kind of a trick for bike boulevards. But at Madison also, at the same time, they're doing these very low-stress neighborhood streets, making them as pleasant as possible and optimizing bicycle movement. They're not saying, okay, that's all we need to do now, and we can ignore the arterials. This is Highway 51, 151. It leads to the state capitol. It used to be 3 13-foot lanes in each direction, 35,000 cars a day using this corridor. And they decided that, it was no bike lanes. They narrowed down the lanes 10 feet, added a 6-foot lane bike lane. They still had extra room to now put a boulevard between the sidewalk and the bike lane. And it's totally they still 35,000 cars a day using Highway 151. It's the main drag getting into the city. But now, for the pedestrian and the bicyclist, it's made all the difference in the world. And what we find is oftentimes, even people, when I went out to Madison, I talked to like a bike shop owner that had a shop right on Washington Avenue. I was saying, wow, this is going to be great, right? He goes, nobody's going to ever bike on Washington Avenue. That's such a dangerous street. You know, he just could not imagine it being different than what it was. But later on, when they do counts, they find, wow, not only now are lots of people using this street to bike on, because there was really no alternative, but the crash rate has gone down dramatically. Again, you get cyclists into a dedicated space, get them off the sidewalk, crash rates drop, ridership increases. It's a win-win for everyone. So it's, again, you know, these when I go into the cities, oftentimes I find that the only way I can get from point A to point B are on these busy streets. I was on Glenwood Avenue for a while. Not a fun place to be. But it's like, that doesn't mean you don't do anything. Those are the streets that you really need to figure out. I get kind of upset when I see on my Google map that if I drove, it's 22 miles to get from point A to point B, but on a bicycle, it's gonna be 40 miles. It's like, that's not fair, right? And I'm always running late, so I'm usually gonna just do the auto trip map, say avoid highways, which for Google that means avoid interstates. So I still have the legal right to use these streets, but it's not very pleasant. But I'm not going to go twice as far because I'm using my bike for transportation. Even though I love bicycling, I only have so much energy I want to expend every day, and I can't always take the scenic route. All right. Now we're going to go into some of the other E's, primarily education. Tucson has done more than anybody that I can tell in terms of really advancing the knowledge of how to use a bicycle proficiently. And they understood long ago that you can offer lots of classes, but people won't show up. So what they've done is they have these pop-up tents, bike stations. They go to the farmers markets. They go to campus. They go to where people are already going to be, and they set these things up. They give away maps. Maybe you've done some of that already here, too, because you're smart people. So, yes, the answer is you have done it, which is good. But then people do stop. Even people who aren't into bicycling might stop just out of curiosity. And they find out, they look at the map, they find out, wow, it wouldn't be that hard for me to bike to work or bike to the farmer's market or bike to the Bulls game, whatever, that this could work out for me. So just going where people are at and providing these educational materials and talking to people makes a big difference. Most people, the reason why they start biking isn't because suddenly there was a bike lane that was built in front of their house, although that helps. But think of yourselves. How many people in this room were influenced by somebody else who just sort of like say, hey, this you should try this. It's kind of fun. Raise your hand if you were influenced by somebody and that got you thinking about bicycling. All right, so about half of you. And then the other half, you just always sort of knew, right? And then you've been influencing probably the half that raised their hand. I don't know. So, but it's people. It's having this engagement, face-to-face encounters. That's why I have to thank Trek for letting me do these travels, because before, it used to just be people submitted their application. We never saw who was submitting their application. We never actually saw what was on the ground. And now I get to go around, meet people face-to-face, actually see all the energy in a community, all the wonderful people working on this stuff. And the whole program has kind of come alive. Trek saw that would actually help this program. My job, actually, in case you were wondering, is to help cities get to the next level. And granted, spending a half a day somewhere or even a full day, it's a challenge to say, oh, well, here's what you need to do. But bringing people together does seem to make a difference, right? So today, before the ride, people met others that they hadn't met before and realized, oh, wow, you're doing this? This is great. We should talk about that. That's how things happen. That's how change happens. People make change happen, and that requires interaction. All right, so Palo Alto, we had a great visit at one of the Apollo School, showing the bike to school day and the impact that's having. If you really want to see how to have an impact on children, I know Palo Alto is sort of a different demographic in terms of size, and that's Stanford University. Hey, come on, Duke University ought to be as good as Stanford. Anyway, one of the schools, 70% of the kids, this is an elementary school, 70% of the kids bike to school. Across the entire school district, K through 12, it's 50%. And they've got this documented. I would not have believed that, except that I was there in the morning seeing all these kids. I mean, the streets are filled with children biking to school. I have never been so blown away from a bicycling scene, even including my travels in Europe, than what I saw in Palo Alto. How do they do that? They have two people employed at the city working with PTAs, teachers. It's mostly a volunteer effort, though. They get parents involved, just like what you're doing here, but it's just You know, it's just been going on longer. And they do, every child at third grade actually gets on bike safety instruction. They learn all the rules. If kids don't have a bike, they're provided with a bicycle, part of the school fleet, or the city fleet of bikes, folding bikes, I believe. And they learn at third grade. And at some of the busy intersections, they have crossing guards to help the kids. This is actually a place where it's a scramble, you could call it, or a Barnes dance, where all, you know, every direction is a walk. Motorists have to stop, so some of the kids are taking advantage of that, crossing diagonally. The crossing guard is helping them do that. But it's just amazing, and more bike parking at these schools than you can even imagine. So and again, Palo Alto has a link on their website about their Safe Routes to School program and how it became as successful as it is. So pretty cool. Again, remember that triangle? Yes.
Does that contribute to
an overall biking culture for community? It seems to, because, you know, so here's the deal. In Palo Alto, so the question was, does this also contribute to overall kind of bike culture that makes biking to work more likely to happen? And I would say yes. First of all, one of the ways that they got so many kids to bike to school is they were able to start a program to get parents to bike with their children to school. And parents that could not do that, there would be a parent in that neighborhood that would volunteer to bike with 6, 7, 8 kids, and they call them a bicycle train. You know, there's a walking school bus, there's a bicycle train. And it got to the point where it became an institution, really. And so now parents, there are some parents that still drop their kids off at the school, but they're so sheepish about it. Like, I'm sorry, it's like they're apologizing because, you know, what is the norm in most American communities is now like something that people in Palo Alto are sort of like, you know, if you were to throw a plastic bottle into a trash can, you know, it's like, I hope nobody saw me do that, you know. So some of those parents then continue on. I saw a number of them. They would ride with their child to school and then continue biking to their workplace. So absolutely. And the other thing that we know is this has kind of been for, you know, the 90s and into this decade, that missing link. You know, we've seen good growth in bike commuting, but a real decrease in kids biking to school because of a lot of it is, you know, parents are afraid to let their kids bike or walk to school, not just traffic, but you know, other things. You know, my kid could be kidnapped, etc. So what has happened is we've a lot of children just don't have that ability and confidence that a lot of us had when we were growing up. It's really a shame. So in Palo Alto, they're building that foundation, so we can expect that in 10 years, 15 years, these kids will, you know, they're never going to give it up. They're going to just know the sheer joy of cycling, like all of us, right? So you remember this? Largely, I want to focus on how do you make it advantageous? Because that's, if you really want to see the increase happening soon, you know, that's the thing to focus on. But even a bike lane on a road diet provides advantages. You think about how many of you have been on a bike lane during rush hour and all the cars are going about 5 miles per hour, if that, and you're just like, it's kind of fun, isn't it? Right. And do you sometimes feel sorry for the people in their car? No, not too much. So that's an advantage, having dedicated space and not having just share the road type situation. You're getting an advantage that people can't ignore. But the other thing are creating shortcuts. So wherever you can find a place to put in a shortcut, this is from Vancouver, but it's a good example. A lot of bike boulevards exist where there's already like, you know, a dead end for motorists on a street, and then they work getting an easement to get a shortcut for bicyclists and pedestrians going through. You've got that here in a couple places already. And it just make sure you mark it as you know, dead end for cars. So many places I'll go, I'll be riding, and it'll say dead end. And I think, well, is that really a dead end, or is that just for cars? You know, and then I'll maybe waste my energy going a full block to find out, oh, there isn't a cut through for me. But sometimes there is, and then kind of it's nice when that exists. But please make sure people know that you have this advantage. There is a trail. This is a, you know, maybe not the most ideal sort of grade to get to the campus drive, but it still works, right? So other things, you know, bike sharing makes bicycling more convenient in an area. Oh yeah, I forgot to tell you that, and you're doing this already, but if you do have questions or comments, just, this is supposed to be interactive, but you know, I get going and sometimes I don't let people, you know, raise their hand, but please do. And if anything you want to talk more about, we can go back to. This will be done in about 15 minutes, but I do want to have time for discussion. And if you want to actually make sure people hear what you have to say, I'll give you this mic so the TV land can also hear what you have to say. Otherwise, I'll just repeat your comment or question, and if I don't do it justice, you know, let me know. So it's up to this point, any comments or questions that you've been dying to ask? Yes, in the back.
You mentioned the protected bike lanes.
Protected bike lanes, yes. Yeah, it's an excellent question. The question was, in discussing protected bike lanes versus just regular bike lanes, paint on the street, do we have guidance when you do one versus the other? And the gentleman also was saying that, you know, if it's just a bike lane, it's not going to be enough to want for him to want to bring his children out there. But even any kind of, you know, physical separation or a post, or, you know, it could even maybe be plastic bollards, can increase that level of comfort. And especially on busier streets, and you had mentioned busier streets, and that's really, so what we're recommending is, they do, well, first of all, they're about 35 times on average more expensive than just painted lane. And that's even true if you're talking about paint that's creating a buffer zone. Because you really want to do it right. The devil's in the details, and you want to make sure, like I said before, they almost have to be treated. When you have that protection, you've got to really work out the details at the intersections. And typically it means more of a downtown kind of street where you have a separate signal for the bikes, a separate phase. Because you don't want turning motorists, especially if they're on the left side of the street. You don't want people thinking they have the ability to make a left turn or a right turn at the same time, because the sight lines aren't as good. When you have, whether it's, so a lot of protected bike lanes or cycle tracks, the way they do it is with parked cars. Instead of the cars being on the right side of you as a cyclist, they're on the left side. And you've got this space now. The car provides a buffer from the moving traffic. Well, that also reduces the visibility. The sight lines aren't as good. And we know there have been situations where fatalities have occurred because of right-turning motorists or left-turning motorists not seeing the bicyclist. Bicyclists going really fast, thinking they were in a safe place, thinking they had the green, and they did have the green. So you really have to treat them as separate roadways. So they're more expensive. So what we recommend is these become signature projects like San Francisco. You really do it right. You spend some money, but they are transformative, and they are necessary. The higher the speeds, the more traffic, the more it seems like, yeah, this really makes sense here. But it's always, you got to weigh all those things between. But, my feeling is it's better to do something than wait for when you have the resources to do something that's really wonderful, right? I don't want perfect to be the enemy of the good. And sometimes you get what you can. You take advantage of the opportunity. So when resurfacing projects are happening, that's an easy time to do a road diet. It doesn't cost anything additionally to restripe that street and add bike lanes, either by narrowing the travel lanes that exist or by reducing the number of travel lanes. So now you have space for those bike lanes. That's the first step. Maybe you find out, okay, wow, people are really liking this, and we're getting a lot of demand here, and people want something even better. So then the next phase becomes the protected bike lanes. I guess if I spend that much time answering every question, we're going to easily go into the 115 mode, but that's okay. Yeah. Oh, actually, there were a couple of people before you. You and then, sorry I have to say you because I don't know you, but. This is one of those situations where I probably should have handed the mic over, because how am I going to do justice to that comment? But basically, there's a concern. Already there's some pretty strong incentives to want a bike to like Duke University, because parking is a huge problem. And yet, there are no good routes, safe streets, in your opinion, to allow that to happen in an easy, low-stress way. So, I mean, Dale can maybe respond to this, but I think that's part of the planning that's going on now, is how do we make these connections happen? How do you build that on-street network, and it might also include some off-street trails, to really make this viable for more and more people? I'm showing you some examples, again, like Campus Drive. It doesn't need to be widened to change how people view that street and make it seem more comfortable. But when you get more resources and there is money available to do it and take it to the next level. And I know Dell is aware of some of those, and you've been successful in getting some of those dollars too. But I'm going to show you some more examples. But first, I want to. Yeah. Yeah, so the question is, you can have a community bicycle friendly, but, actually getting from one community to another, it might not be so easy. Or you can have a bicycle friendly campus, and yet the connections to downtown or other places, it's not so easy to to transverse. And we do have, so we do find in some places like Tucson, they don't do the application. It's the East Pima County Metropolitan Planning Organization that does the application, and they really are working regionally to make all those connections happen. You're fortunate here, in fact, that Dale is half-time with the city of Durham, also half-time with the MPO. Unfortunately, that MPO is separate from the MPO over in Raleigh, right? So, but I'm sure Dale works with that MPO too. But yeah, this is the challenge that we see everywhere. You know, it's like there's got to be this dialogue and planning efforts happening that transcend city boundaries. Yes. So the question is, are we working with State Department of Transportation? The answer is yes. We also have a program under our Bicycle Friendly America program called the Bicycle Friendly States, and we rank states from 1 to 50 in terms of their level of bicycle friendliness, and we provide the rationale why. So right now Washington State is number 1 in the country. I don't remember what North Carolina is. But we're looking at policies, we're looking at how much money is being spent at the state level on infrastructure. We're looking at, just how responsive state DOTs are to local concerns. All that kind of stuff goes into the rating system. And states are really starting to, they really hate it when they're like, number 48 or 49 or 50 or even 30. So they're paying attention to that ranking, and I think we're seeing the bar continuously raised up. Dale, do you want to say a few words? Yeah.
I guess I did want to, Hassan, to address the question about the connections to Chapel Hill briefly. The MPO has been working on a connection to Chapel Hill for, it's been almost 10 years now, on Old Durham Chapel Hill Road. And that project should be under construction next year, between, it will begin at Garrett Road in Durham, going over to about the Blue Cross building in Chapel Hill. And the Chapel Hill section will probably be a little bit lagging behind, but the right-of-way is being acquired right now, and the road should be under construction. The other road you mentioned is Irwin Road, and that's certainly a request or the other road that was mentioned by someone, that's been a request that we've gotten hundreds of times, and our MPO board, we have a representative from our MPO board here, and that's a project that we continually request when we are making our submissions to the state for improvements to our facilities, but it has not risen to the top of the funding, but it certainly is on our radar.
Thank you. Yes, you.
Goes by, Dale might introduce some of our elected officials who are very influential in this process, and we have some city officials, county officials perhaps here who might have given their time to come to listen. I also would like to know if you had any further specific suggestions about things you might do here that are based on your tour that you did this morning. I know you dropped in a few comments earlier about various questions, but if you have more suggestions,
Yeah, I'll let Dale introduce the folks. That's a great idea. Dale will introduce the elected officials that are in the room and also city staff and other agency people. It'd be nice to actually have time to find out everybody's name and who you represent and what your interest is. But to answer your other question, specific recommendations, yes. In fact, we should, once we do the introductions of who's who, I'll finish the PowerPoint here, and that actually talks about some of my recommendations that I have, and also provides kind of a scorecard. So, and we can have more discussion then after that, but it would be good to get through. The most important part, we couldn't, the TV people couldn't hear. No.
Should I go through that again? Okay.
Anybody else have a quick comment or question before I move on? Yes. You know, there's a lot of neat things happening around the country. The question was, what about the bike repair stands that you see around in some places and with pumps, you know, 24-hour basic self-service that you can access. And yeah, I think all that kind of, you know, like covered bike parking, the bike repair stands that you can access, bike corrals in basically using an on-street car parking space, but instead of having the car parked there now, there's room for 10 bicyclists, or actually 12 for some of the designs. And this isn't about getting rid of parking, this is about expanding parking, and it's the business community that wants this. So all those things kind of create more bike culture and just makes people feel like this is a city where they care about bicyclists, and every time somebody sees something like that, it makes them think about, wow, maybe I could ride a bike. You know, and that's the other thing that's really nice about the bike share program is it's this constant advertisement that bicycling is a legitimate form of transportation in this community. So all those things we like to see. And it does make a difference. It builds bike culture, expands awareness, legitimizes bicycling. And it also is nice when you have a flat tire or something, or brakes aren't working so well. So think about ways to, and that's something, that's an advantage that you're giving bicyclists that motorists don't have. I mean, they can pull into a service station. Do they exist really anymore? Not really. It's an oxymoron, right? But they're going to pay somebody some big bucks to fix their car, whereas a bicycle is very simple, and most people can learn. You might want to go to a bike shop first, but learn how to do some basic repair on their bikes. So here's your scorecard. It's not, again, a very good, easy thing to read, but we're looking at the 5 E's. This is largely based on your last application that was submitted, I forget now. Just in August. Since then, there has been, you got 15 points for not having any fatalities, but I know there has been a fatality since the application was actually submitted, or at least what the 5 year period that the crash report was based on. So you might not get all 15 points really for that, but basically you are between a bronze and a silver level right now. 20 out of 100 points is typically where bronze communities are at. 40 is a level of a silver community. 60 is a level of a gold community. But this is kind of a dumbed down version of the actual feedback that we provide. This is more based, this is more of a snapshot of where you are right now. It's been tweaked a little bit to reflect some of the things that you've done since most recent application. But the growth is great, and the outcomes, I mean, you're seeing good, you know, pretty good number in terms you've got good momentum. So, but here's the really fine print is what we want to focus on, but fortunately, you don't have to try to see what that says. It's right here. So number one is you really do need to make those major corridors work for bicyclists. Club Road, Main Street is, you've got a good start on that. Roads like Angier and Pettigrew, I mean, Washington's a good example of just a nice collector that's got bike lanes now. just creating that comprehensive network, because if, you know, it's one thing to have a little, you know, bike lane here, bike lane over there, bike lane down there, but if it's not all connected, it doesn't really do the job. And I would not ever say, oh, well, don't do anything until you can get everything connected. Take advantage of the opportunities when they come up, but then work really hard on the gaps. And anytime there's resurfacing, there's got to be somebody paying attention to the fact that that resurfacing project's going to happen. Now's the time to see if we can make this work for bicyclists better. And usually the answer is, I would say not usually, always, unless you've already got something. And even like when you've got something, you can usually improve it. So like in Chicago now, they used to have a lot of their bike lanes were 5 feet, and then they had an 11-foot travel lane, and then a 7-foot parking lane. And now what they've actually gone back to grind out the 5-foot marking to allow for a 6-foot bike lane. That 1 foot means a lot to bicyclists, and it doesn't really do anything negative to the motorists. In fact, having a 10-foot travel lane instead of 11 feet just means people might drive a little bit more prudently, so it increases safety for everybody. So that's what they're doing. So you can always improve things too. All right, number two, the shortcut thing. I'm really big on, you know, finding ways to make advantages. Really make some of these streets, neighborhood greenways like Watts, just make it an official bike street. And maybe selling it, maybe that's not how you sell it. In Portland now they're getting away from bike boulevard terminology. They're saying neighborhood greenway. These are streets that people want to live on because of the traffic calming influence. And what they found in Portland now, these bike boulevards or neighborhood greenways, more people are bicycling on them than driving. In fact, it's like they can get 5,000 bicyclists going down these residential streets, and maybe, you know, 500 at most motorists. So number three is really continue the momentum you've got with the connections you've made with the school district and schools. Work with those PTAs, build that foundation with the children, get something going. It's really a shame that kids feel like they can't bike to school. I know with the magnet schools, that makes it a little bit more problematic. But, you know, you do what you can. And just having that training, you know, being able to, we, in Minnesota now, the physical education teachers are learning how to teach bike safety, and a fleet is being provided, and there's grants for that kind of thing. So those are my recommendations, but again, I was here shortly. Now I'd like to open it up to what people think. And that really was my last slide.
So my question is more around what support is provided perhaps to local businesses. You mentioned Fort Collins being, you know, very bike friendly because of the Fat Tire New Belgium company there, and that they supported cycling within their community of their business, therefore they'd help provide infrastructure. Again, with a certain unnamed local university that may or may not, they may do a great support internally on campus, but externally getting to campus or providing support for employees who don't want to be ripe throughout the whole day without a shower after cycling in. You know, are there education programs and materials provided such that employers in the area could help be more supportive of employees who want to commute and not do without some basic essentials like a shower?
Well, that's a great question. Her question was, are there programs in support that can be provided to entities like the university to encourage them to become bicycle-friendly businesses, and in fact, this would help elevate the bicycle friendliness of the city of Durham. Yes, absolutely. The first recommendation is that the city of Durham can lead the way and be the model for other businesses, workplaces. And I know they are doing a lot of good stuff here at the city. You're a silver bicycle-friendly business. We encourage, so one of the things we look at in the application of the bicycle-friendly community application is how many bicycle-friendly businesses do you have? And by businesses, we're looking at workplaces. Separate from that, we also have a bicycle-friendly university program. And people, I mean, it would be worthwhile for like a task force to be formed to help more businesses become bike-friendly, the university become, I forget if Duke ever applied. I think they have a bike-friendly. And, you know, bike sharing is happening on Duke University's campus. A lot of good things are happening, but we can do more. There's an effort in Long Beach, there was an effort, to create a bicycle-friendly district. And getting some feedback. And that basically, like a person was hired, or contracted by the city, to go to all these different businesses and talk about the value of becoming bicycle-friendly, what that would do to their customer base, increase their sales, et cetera. It was a huge success. And then they become proponents for more, you know, for like the protected bike lanes downtown. It's usually the business community, once they become aware of the impact this can have, that they take the lead on this. So, yeah, it's a synergy that happens. I don't know if that answered your question, but it's really important. And that's the need for what we had today. You know, all these different people coming together and meet and talk and trying to figure out what can we do together, how can we make this better for everybody. It's all about partnerships. I have maybe time for two more. They told me that after 1:30 we're all going to turn into pumpkins.
Have you gathered any data on general safety increases in communities after there are increases in bicycle traffic? And my thinking here is that people on bicycles are traveling more slowly through the community and are more eyes on the street in a more effective way. And so I'm wondering if anybody's been able to do any study on that and capture any data.
Yeah. That's a great question. And in fact, what we know from Long Beach and Tempe, Arizona, when they did bicycle infrastructure, and New York City's been doing some of this now too, that in both situations, their number one retail district in terms of sales tax revenues are those places where they, in the case of Tempe, Mill Avenue, Google Mill Avenue, it's the number one most successful retail district, mostly bars and restaurants, in the Phoenix area. Before, it was four lanes, actually in some places five lanes, fast moving traffic. They did a road diet, two lanes with a beautiful little boulevard and nice wide bike lanes, totally transformed that whole district. People, exactly what you were saying, that now they're going slower, they're stopping. It's a place where people want to be. And before it was just like, here's a place that we want to get through, because it was just a commuting route. Long Beach, Belmont Shore, they did the green, actually just a green sort of Cheryl down the right lane. They said that made all the difference in the world, and the sales have never been better, and now even families are riding down. Basically, the right lane is like has turned into a bike lane for the most part, and they just use the entire lane. So great question. And then we also know when ridership goes up, there's a safety in numbers phenomena. That's been proven now, where crash rates go way down. Okay, two more minutes. That's you.
So this is my question is not so much about infrastructure as it is about public education. what you guys have worked at all with communities about, you know, public service announcements, you know, for the non-cyclists. I mean, I've been in this industry for a long time. It's allowed me to travel the world, you know, live in a lot of cities around the country, and I haven't seen the kind of, I hate to use the word animosity towards cyclists as I do here. I mean, I grew up in North Carolina, but there is an animosity from non-cyclists towards cyclists. And I'm wondering what you guys have seen from other communities.
So, yeah, that's a great question, too. First of all, I will say that I rode on some pretty busy streets yesterday. It was a Sunday. Nobody honked at me. Everybody gave me lots of respect. So I want to say that so far my experience has been motorists are pretty decent here. That being said, Orange County is a great example of a place, and L.A. County, where they've done these wonderful PSAs. It's not coming from bike advocates. It's coming from the Metropolitan Planning Organization. Basically, billboards and bumper stickers that say, every road is a bike lane. Every lane is a, I mean, and they have these pictures of basically bicyclists in the center of a travel lane saying, sometimes there's not room for a bike lane. Sometimes bicyclists can use a full lane. That's their right. Respect their right. I mean, it's like really effective. In some of my PowerPoints, I have that billboard. It's on buses too. Every road is a bike lane. And that goes a long way towards creating that legitimacy. All these things work. I mean, I could come up with other examples, but our time is up. Thank you, everybody, for being here. And keep up the good work.